Although racism and discrimination has existed throughout many civilizations, the nature of systemic and institutionalized racism in the modern world remains a serious challenge for all of us. Is there a way to harness the power of technology to disestablish those racist frameworks?
Institutional racism is definitely a big problem, but I don't think that technology is the solution to this particular problem. Human societies face generally two different kinds of problems. Some problems result from objective causes, things that don't depend on human beliefs. If you think about an epidemic like COVID-19, it's caused by a virus. And the virus exists outside our minds. It exists whether people believe in it or not. And technology is good, quite good, at solving these kinds of objective problems. You can invent a vaccine, eliminate the virus, and thereby overcome the epidemic. But there is a second kind of problems. Problems which are caused by imaginary things, by fictions. And racism is such a problem. Racism is not caused by a virus. People do infect each other with racism, but they do it by telling fictional stories, not by sneezing and passing the virus. Racism is rooted in fictional stories that exist in our imagination. And there is nothing outside our own minds which forces humans to be racist. So unless you invent a technology to control minds, there isn't a technological way to destroy the deep source of racism. And I guess even if you invent a technology to control minds, this will obviously be very dangerous because somebody could use it to increase racism instead of to eliminate it. We just need to think about, say, how the Nazis used the mind-controlling technology of mass media to realize how dangerous it is. Now, all this doesn't mean that we can't solve racism. We can and we should. But the solution would come from exploring and developing our minds and our institutions and our societies, and not from inventing some technological gadget. Racism is our mess. We created this mess and we need to clean it ourselves instead of outsourcing the job to a computer.
My question is, how do you think we can build back better after COVID-19 and have a more equal society?
That's a big issue. I think people disagree about a lot of things regarding COVID-19, but there is at least one lesson that everybody should take from this pandemic, and this is that we should invest more in our healthcare systems, and in particular, we need to provide good healthcare for every human being on Earth. You know, people talk a lot about the need to guard national borders, but the really important border that we need to guard is the border between the human world and the virus world. And this border, it passes inside the body of each and every human being. If a dangerous virus manages to penetrate this border anywhere on Earth, it puts the whole human species in danger. If a virus jumps from a bat to the body of a human being in some poor village in a remote country, that is a direct threat to your life too. So it's in your interest, in everybody's interest, that all people everywhere will enjoy good healthcare.
I'm a huge fan of the book Sapiens by Yuval Harari and looking forward to seeing this edition. Was there a time in which humans were much more cooperative and there isn't evidence of large-scale war? And if so, how do we get back there? Thank you.
Hey, Lily, thanks for this. Actually, there is no evidence for war from most of the Stone Age. The first evidence for large-scale conflict is only from about 13,000 years ago from a place called Jabal Sakhaba in the Nile Valley. And this was a little before the agricultural revolution. But once agriculture spread, large-scale war spread with it. However, obviously we can't just give up agriculture and go back to living as Stone Age hunter-gatherers, because back then the planet supported about 8 million people, and today we have 8 billion people, so if we really try to go back, 99% of us will starve. And that's the bad news. But there is good news. The good news is that if we consider the period after the agricultural revolution, then we are now living in the most peaceful and cooperative time. There are still wars in some parts of the world. I personally come from the Middle East, so I know this perfectly well. But if you look at the overall global picture, war now kills fewer people than car accidents or suicide or obesity-related illnesses. So we can say that sugar is probably a bigger threat to your life than gunpowder. Now, this doesn't mean that things are perfect, of course. Things are actually still quite bad, but they are better than ever. And realizing how much we have already managed to achieve, it doesn't mean that we should become smug and complacent. It means that we should be more responsible. It makes us realize that it's not like there is some law of nature that dictates the level of violence in the world. The level of violence depends on the decisions that we humans take. Unfortunately, we've gotten so used to the current era of relative peace that we now take it for granted, and we are therefore becoming very careless in our decisions. Instead of doing everything we can to strengthen the fragile global order that preserves the relative peace of the world, countries neglect this order or even deliberately undermine it. The global order, you can say, is something like a house that everybody inhabits, but nobody bothers to repair. It can hold on for a few more years, but if we continue like this, like we're doing now, it will collapse, and we will find ourselves back in the jungle of constant war. And if this happens, we will have to again start worrying about gunpowder much more than about sugar.
Hello, huge fan over here. Do you ever think about branching into other mediums? As factual as your books so far have been, do you think, for example, that Sapiens or Homo Deus could be adapted into a fictional TV show?
Oh, great questions. And I think about it a lot, actually, together with my team at Sapienship. Our main aim is to raise awareness of the most important problems that are facing humankind and to try and engage the largest audience possible in a scientifically sound conversation. We already created a graphic novel series about the history of humanity, and we are working on an immersive exhibition, and we would be very, very happy to create a fictional TV show as well. What we've seen in recent years with things like climate change and COVID-19 is that if scientists don't make the effort to bring science to everyone, you actually leave the arena free for all kinds of misinformation campaigns and conspiracy theories. And in order to really reach everyone, science can't do it by itself. Science needs help from art. Humans are storytelling animals. We think in stories. And the problem for scientists is that reality never presents itself as a story. Reality is much more messy. So the job of scientists, including historians, whether they write books or make films or TV shows, is to take the messy reality and somehow turn it into a clear and engaging story. And that always demands a lot of imagination. You can never tell history without some help from fiction. Think, for example, about, let's say, the Second World War. Suppose you want to show the Second World War as it really happened. And suppose you even have a time machine and you can go back in time with a camera and make a documentary TV show about the Second World War. You would still need to rely on your imagination. Because in TV, we always have a framework, right? The camera is pointing at a particular place. The hero, the big hero, is in the focus. Other characters are on the sidelines, and most people, they don't appear at all, ever. So in your show about the Second World War, would we point the camera at Hitler or at Churchill or maybe at a group of Chinese villagers? They were also there in the war. And in our opening scene, do we show German troops storming into Poland? Or do we show 5-year-old Hitler torturing flies in his backyard? Which of those is reality? There is a degree of fiction to any choice we make because reality really has no frame, no focus, and no obvious heroes. Reality doesn't have a beginning and a middle and an end. Reality just goes on and on and on forever. Choosing between all the facts and deciding how to weave the facts together into a story always demands imagination. When it comes to telling a story in a way that will be both accurate and compelling, the visual medium of TV is, I guess, even more challenging and requires more difficult choices than writing books. Because you literally have to ask yourself, what does reality look like? It took me years to write Sapiens and Homo Deus, so who knows how long it would take to adapt them for the screen, but I'm totally up for it.
My other question is, you've created huge pieces of work. Do you ever feel like you will never have another idea? If not, how come? If so, what do you do to overcome that thought?
As for the second question, well, as an author, I don't really look for ideas. I let them find me. I try never to commit in advance to writing a book because it creates far too much pressure. I'm afraid to find myself forced to write and publish something, not because I think it's important, but because I committed to some deadline. If ideas come to my mind and I think they are important, so I'll write them down, and only when I'm sure that this really merits publication, I'll contact my publishers and say that, hey, I have a new book. And what if ideas don't come, if there are no ideas? I think I'll be quite happy to just remain silent. I've probably said enough for several lifetimes already. And every year I go on a silent meditation retreat for a month or two, and it's really a wonderful time. So I think I'm not afraid of an empty mind.
Why does humanity seem incapable of stopping our negative environmental impact when we know the catastrophic effect that it's going to have on our future, on our survival as a race?
Well, one reason is that we are trapped by our own success. As a civilization, we've learned to solve problems by making more stuff. When people demand a bigger slice of the pie, for centuries, our answer has always been the same thing: let's enlarge the pie. Let's have more food, more energy, more stuff, more money. And the political pressure to keep enlarging the pie is immense, because we lack the political imagination to do anything else. And this is true of almost all countries and all ideologies. It doesn't matter if you're a capitalist or socialist, Christian, Muslim, Hindu, secular, everybody, everywhere, seek to enlarge the pie. In most countries, if a government was to adopt, say, better environmental policies at the cost of economic slowdown and unemployment and low standards of living, that government would soon fall. I'm not sure that we have the time to imagine a different kind of politics, because imagination is hard work. It takes centuries to dream up new stories, a new kind of politics. But maybe, just maybe, we can find a way to enlarge the pie without unbalancing the ecosystem. And the magic number here is 2%. If we invest 2% of global GDP in developing new eco-friendly technologies and building new eco-friendly infrastructure, that should be enough to prevent catastrophic climate change. Now, 2% of global GDP is of course a lot of money, but it's still feasible. If it was 20%, it was probably hopeless. But 2%, I think we can do that. The typical job of politicians is exactly to shift 2% of the budget from here to there. So as citizens, we should pressure our politicians to do exactly that. It's a concrete, clear, and feasible target, 2%.
My question is, if the first agricultural revolution led to war, disease, and inequality, is there any chance, do you think, that a new agricultural revolution can mitigate any of those consequences?
Well, the good news is that this has already happened. The scientific and technological developments of the last 200 years or so have completely revolutionized agriculture and have solved many of the problems which were caused by the original agricultural revolution. The first agricultural revolution, 12,000 years ago, it led to famines by making humans dependent on a very small number of vulnerable crops. But thanks to the new agricultural revolution, now, for the first time in history, more people actually die from eating too much than from eating too little, which is a huge achievement. The first agricultural revolution also led to epidemics. By cramming together many people and many animals and goats and pigs and chickens and whatever into dense, unhygienic settlements, the agricultural revolution created a hothouse for epidemics, like germ paradise. But thanks to modern science and hygiene systems and vaccinations and antibiotics, now, for the first time in history, more people die from old age diseases than from infectious diseases. This is another wonderful achievement. The bad news is that the new revolution didn't just solve many of the old problems, it also created a host of new problems, like the threats of global war and ecological collapse and disruptive technologies. And that's actually very typical. In history, when we humans solve an old problem, we often inadvertently create a new problem. In essence, if we look at thousands of years of history, what we see is that humans are becoming more and more powerful, but we aren't becoming significantly happier. We humans are very good at gaining more power, but we aren't good at all at translating power into happiness. I'm quite confident that we will gain a lot more power in the coming century, which will solve many of the problems that now bother us. But I'm also quite certain that this will lead to new problems which we can hardly even imagine today. So, what will become of us? I think that we will become gods, we will acquire divine powers of creation and destruction, but we will be dissatisfied gods.